Let's get another version of this from young Bill Bowkett. Welcome to the show, Bill.
Very good evening, and hopefully I could live up to someone as legendary as John Rental in this place.
Bill, welcome. And as John Lennon said, the audition starts now. It's nice to speak to you for the very first time, sir. And I've been reading your tweets all week, and I've read a number of your articles in preparation for this. Give us your take, for the benefit of the audience who hasn't read your reaction piece, about the sudden resignation of Owen Paterson MP.
Well, first of all, it's very shocking manner, of course. I think for me, my general take on it, or my analysis and perspective from it, is that in regards to the reforms, the motion that was trying to be pushed through in Parliament to reform the sleaze watchdog, the Standards Committee, then actually there were some very logical reasons why the committee may need reforming. So one aspect in which several backbench Conservative MPs said it needed reforming was to give members of Parliament the right to appeal should they been found guilty of a certain manner, and that it results in a suspension. But it's the timing of it that's just come awfully, and it almost seems from a voter's, an outsider perspective, that it's almost Boris Johnson is trying to save his pal, you know, a former cabinet minister in Owen Paterson, for, you know, essentially egregious behaviour. And I think, as we're seeing with reports of MPs receiving angry emails from constituents, that early YouGov poll in the days afterwards, and potentially the impact that it might have for the Conservative Party in the two by-elections they'll be competing in for Paterson seats and for Brokenshires, I think it's a really aggravating thing for them.
So is there a possibility that in North Shropshire it might be coloured Lib Dem or even Labour, this by-election?
Well, there is a lot to talk about, and in my piece on the evening newsletter I did for Reaction on Friday, I basically put that question forward because, as we saw with Cheshire and Amersham, it had a 16,000 seat majority, Conservative majority, prior to that by-election being called. But of course, as we saw as the campaign occurred, the local issue, particularly this issue of NIMBYism versus YIMBYism, was rowing. You might see a particular instance now happen in North Shropshire in regards to Owen Paterson. So there was talk at the start, a rumour that maybe the Greens, the Labour and Liberal Democrats would get behind an independent anti-sleeve candidate. But that's not happening. They're instead going to stand. However, particularly when it comes to Liberal Democrats and seeing how much that they have an advantage perhaps on the centre ground, that they might run a direct campaign where they could put all their resources into those two constituencies and really kind of target in and really expose it. Whether they can, you know, result in getting 22,000 votes out is a question, but yeah, yes. You've also got to put into that other political parties as well. Maybe the Reform Party is a question. So you're seeing Richard Tice standing in Brokenshire seats, and if they decide to stand also in North Shropshire, then they could take away that traditional Tory base of voters that feel disenfranchised for the Conservative Party because they see them as untrustworthy.
I tell you what, Bill, there is a very, very different sentiment to the by-election involving poor James Brokenshire, though, isn't there? I mean, it's very difficult to see that the untimely early death of a much-loved politician, and there's not many of those around, will actually manifest itself in a Tory being re-elected there. Perhaps it might have been more apt for Richard to stand in the North Shropshire election.
Yeah, potentially it might have been the case, but I feel that it still will have a prevalent thing within that. I think with as unfortunate, as untimely as any death of an MP is, you know, once time is settled and a date is set, then that's kind of put to one side and the campaign's going to be forward. And the other issue that the Conservative Party, I think, will have, not just, you know, the entire fabric of the Conservative Party, whether they're trustworthy, is their recent stance in the economy as well. And indeed, as I've been listening into your show, maybe the impact that their net zero strategy will have on, you know, voters' behaviour and whether they see it's impacting in their lives, and whether essentially, I think with these by-elections, they're going to act almost as referendums on the current support base of the Conservative Party since the local elections we had back in May.
So this is a very interesting time, and of course it's a kind of disproportionate barometer, isn't it? I mean, by-elections do sometimes go the way of the other party in shock wins, but they're sometimes not actually the barometer of popularity, are they, that people make out? And sometimes, in rare cases, they're a chance to be an informal referendum on a local issue, as they were in that election up above North London that the Lib Dems won about 6 months ago.
Interesting amendment.
Exactly.
Yeah, no, that's definitely the case. And there is, it can be a bit disproportionate as well, given how much media attention by-elections get, and the fact that party HQs are essentially able to put all their resources into yes. one candidate, rather than, you know, when the general election occurs, they have to rely on, you know, the support of volunteers, often unpaid. And sometimes, as you see, local issues can dominate rather than what we can often talk about within the Westminster bubble. And that was one of the things that we saw with the passing story. Many people were saying that, oh, it's, I think Laura Kunzberg made a tweet about it where she said it's a Westminster bubble story. But we don't know that yet. And we don't know the initial backlash. And we don't know, I mean, we've heard, as I said, reports of, you know, MPs receiving angry emails from constituents, and we've seen, we can look at polls as much as we want. But then I also saw a YouGov poll which said that only 28% of people have actually been following the whole affair when it comes to Paterson. So, but yeah, that's the thing you've got to take into account with by-elections. And often as journalists, we can often be culprit of bigging up them to the point where it's almost questioning the entire leadership or the entire, you know, mold compass and support of a politician like Boris Johnson, and like we saw with Keir Starmer and Hartlepool, which, if I'm honest, when we saw the 2019 general election, he should have lost that seat, but it only was because of Richard Tice standing in that, meaning that the Conservatives lost that in the end.
Mm. Right, so can we just go back a week and discuss the budget now? Because in a moment I'm going to talk to Russell Quirk, who you'll know and I'll know that he's a mortgage and property expert. And I'm going to put the question to him, the position to him, which I know he'll disagree with, which is part of the fun of hosting a radio show. Not to upset your friends, but I think Rishi Sunak is actually quite an investable, confidence-boosting chancellor, despite the criticism of his budget. Let's face it, you know, he has been on the end of pelters, a bit like Boris has in the popular press and amongst John Major today. This from both his backbenchers and, of course, the traditional Conservative voters, viewed as just another tax and spend chancellor that we've almost seen continuously for the last 25 years. The economy really runs on mass sentiment, not just of the global markets, but also individuals. And I'm just posing this question that whatever you think of his individual policies, whether you're a Tory voter who's disaffected or a Labour voter who welcomes a lot of these tax and spend ideas, is he actually inspiring you to be more brave to make big key decisions in your life? Buying your house, spending a bit more on home improvements, taking a holiday that you may not think you could have afforded a year ago, worrying a little bit about inflation, things like gas bills, taking out a bit of a wage. But, you know, people are people feel emboldened by being not locked down anymore. And I'm just wondering whether Rishi Sunak is part of the confidence of this country. Seriously.
I think he is in many ways, because within the Conservative, within the traditional Tory voters, he is extremely popular. I think in the most recent Conservative Home rankings of cabinet MPs, I think he's the third most popular, only behind Wallace and also Liz Truss. And actually, as you said, I think it does give voters and consumers a boost as well. And we've seen that during the pandemic, he has had is notable successes. I think the furlough scheme, whilst as critical as it may be in, building up debt, it has, kept people off the dole, and it has made sure that almost encouraging people to go back to work through the Kickstarter scheme as well. I think often when it comes to these two aspects, you have, policy over politician. And Rishi Sunak obviously is a very charismatic leader. I was there at a Conservative Party conference when, he was giving his main address and, speaking to members. They at the start, they just felt very disgruntled over, the tax rises, the health and social care plan. But once he got on that stage and he was kind of giving his case of why actually it's conservative in order to, be fiscally prudent and also to be manageable within the economy, that almost there's that trust wave when he says that tax cuts will come about and the economy will bounce back from coronavirus and we will be innovative, when it comes to AI and when it comes to the net zero strategy as well. You've got to take that into account, I think. So yeah, that's absolutely the case. And I think if Boris Johnson were to suddenly resign as Prime Minister, then Rishi Sunak most certainly, I think within not just the party, but in the eyes of voters, could certainly be the country's next Prime Minister.
Oh, now you have teed up my next thought perfectly, Bill, which is the race to be the next leader of the Conservative Party. Now, of course, this will be the number one story on this radio station and every other media outlet when that happens. It's not on the horizon just yet, despite perhaps the wishes of certain people on the backbenches and political commentators and former prime ministers aside. But there are more than one people. That's a terrible way of saying it, isn't it?
What language am I speaking?
There are at least three candidates, I think, that could succeed Boris Johnson. And obviously, Rishi Sunak is out there as the highest profile. But I'm looking at people like Tom Tugendhat and also Liz Truss, who's making very, very positive and firm affirmative noises, real positive stuff coming out about Liz as well. And I'm just wondering, actually, whether Rishi, would have this leadership challenge to himself. I think there's some pretty decent talent coming through the Tory ranks on the front benches.
Definitely. If there ever were to be a leadership race, I think it would be, one of the most exciting in quite a long time. I think with the last leadership election, it almost seemed, at least for me, I don't know whether others would feel like that as well, but I always had a sense that almost Boris was kind of destined in many ways to be Prime Minister. We've known it for a long time and before that. And then obviously he was the one that resigned over May's Chequers deal at the time. Back then he was kind of pummeling his message across and was popular within, the wider press. But I think this time it's much more unpredictable. Obviously, as I mentioned, Rishi Sunak, you would think is the runaway favourite, darling within the Conservative Party, charismatic. But then you've also got Liz Truss, who economically, very, Thatcherite, but when it comes to social issues, much more strong when it comes to things like self-identification, for instance. But then again, she's also popular within the LGBT Tories. So when I was there at Tory Party conference, she often got a very big reception for that. But then you've got others as well, like Priti Patel and even Jeremy Hunt. But I think Tom Tugendhat is the most interesting because whilst his CV lacks in, cabinet experience, but as chair of the Foreign Affairs Select Committee and being, an outspoken critic of Boris Johnson, a very committed conservative, he's eloquent, fluid, he's an impressive operator. I think a leading hawk in many ways, and I think many would fancy a run, although I'm not quite sure whether he's got the status just yet if he were to run for Prime Minister, but certainly one to watch out for.
Indeed, that's why I said him. I like Truss and Tugendhat and Sunak, and as you say, that really would be quite a triangle with, I think, the two you mentioned there, Hunt and Patel coming up in fourth and fifth place. Not forgetting old Jack in the Box, Michael Gove, who was to go for a jolly run when he's in the media, when they queue outside. I know why they doorstep him, because he's so funny in his shorts, isn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. And he's ran for Prime Minister before.
Yeah.
And he is almost becoming the most experienced cabinet minister, given how many cabinet titles he has had. He's been education, environment, cabinet secretary. Now he's the equivalent, well, he's housing and local communities, but then within that, levelling up. And he's also been responsible at the time last year for the key negotiations with the European Union alongside Lord Frost. Another one to Pat, but there's, you know, dozens of others who you can see running, but ultimately only one can stand above the rest.
Only one can do it. Unless you're, of course, the Green Party, where you can have two leaders. Bill, it's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you for the first time. Thank you very much for joining me on the Jonny Gould Show on Talk Radio.
Thank you so much.
That is Bill Bowkett of Reaction website, the political reporter there, with his view of the Tories in government and around government right here on Talk Radio.